Hey everybody, it's Alex with Engineering Applied. In this video, I'll be giving you a detailed overview of the joint command found within an Autodesk Inventor assembly file. If you want more easy to understand and practical content like this, made by an experienced engineer like myself, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any helpful content like this in the future. If you're looking for a specific function, check the description for timestamps. And if you don't find what you're looking for in this video, check out the other videos in my Autodesk Inventor series playlist because I know you'll find exactly what you need there. Let's get started. Okay, everybody. So here we are in our assembly file. And what I have pulled up here is a C clamp that I modeled up. It comes in multiple parts. So you have the body of the C clamp, you have the screw with a pin driven through it, and then you have a little pad at the top that sits on a ball joint. So why am I discussing this now? Well, the joint command allows us to not only position components, but it allows us to take care of their motion characteristics as well, all in one step. So let's go ahead and take a look at our model real quick so I can show you exactly what I mean. When I click and drag this handle on the screw, I'm able to rotate it and translate it up and down just like I can in real life. Now, you'll notice I can also set limits so it won't travel any lower than that or any higher than it can, okay? So this is just a small example of what the joint command can do for us. And we can have various types of joints in one assembly. So let's zoom in on this little pad here. You'll notice it sits and rotates on that ball joint. Okay, I can rotate the part and pivot that about. Now, one thing I'd like to note is if you're unfamiliar with how to place components in an assembly, I encourage you to go watch that video I made on placing components within an assembly first, and then coming back to this video so that you have a strong foundation moving forward through this lesson. Okay, so I went ahead and cleared my workspace so that we can start from scratch, and I'll step through the various joint commands and give you examples for all of those options that are available to us. So the first thing we want to do here is go to place, and we want to pull in the C clamp main body here. So we'll move that in, we'll right click, and then place grounded at origin. Now that that's placed at our origin, we're gonna go ahead and go to our marking menu by right clicking and hitting okay. Now let's go ahead and click on the joint command under the relationships section. So we left click on that. And now we get our place joint command box that pops up, okay? We get two main tabs. Our first tab is joint, and this is where we actually apply our joint constraints or our joint elements, okay? And then we have our limits tab where we can set the limits for the angular and translational displacement of the individual joints themselves, depending on the type of joint you use. If you use a rigid joint, you won't get any of this flexibility because it's a rigid element. So anyways, let's go back to the first tab. Under our type box, this is where we find all of our joint variants. You can leave it on automatic if you want the software to try to guess at what you're trying to do, but I recommend manually selecting exactly what you want to do. That way you don't have to go back and change it after the fact. Your connect section allows you to select the various faces or entities that you want to apply that joint to. Gap allows you to set a gap between that joint that you create and the other body. Okay. Your align section allows you to change and flip the alignment of your two entities. You can enter a custom name as you're creating the element, which is really useful because you want to get specific with your joint naming so that you can find it within your model browser very easily. Okay. And then under your animate section, this will allow you to animate the movement of that joint so you can clearly see what it's allowing you to do. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our first joint type, which is going to be cylindrical. Okay, we're going out of order for the purposes of this video, because since we're building up a realistic model from the ground up, this would be the next logical step in our assembly process. Now that we have our cylindrical type selected, we can move over to our connect section where we could pick up the various anchor points or origins, as they're called in this particular case, for the joint element. You'll see that the first origin selection filter is currently active, and I know that because there's a blue fill on the inside of that box, okay? The second origin one is currently inactive because there is no blue fill inside of the box. I can left click on that to activate that one ahead of time if I want to, but let's go ahead and activate the first one. Now we want to hover over our part of interest, which is going to be the screw. And when I hover over this, you'll notice that the part is outlined in green. And then I get these three little dots up and down the part. Okay. These are our origin locations that we can use. Now, in this particular case, I want to pick up this middle one, but I want to talk about a quick keyboard shortcut that you can use, or a keyboard modifier that allows you to easily select these points without losing the part altogether. So when I hover over this part, I can pick up the points without holding anything on the keyboard. But when I leave this part, you'll see that the green outline goes away and I can no longer select those points. Well, what you can do is you can hover over the part, hold the control key on your keyboard, and now I can leave the part and still have that outlined, okay? So I can hover over these various points and pick that up while I hold the control key. This just makes your selection process all that easier. So let's go ahead while holding control, left click on this middle point here. Now that we've selected our first point, I want you to notice that under the connect section, the second origin selection filter is pre-selected. Okay, so now we can pick up the second origin point to then create this joint relationship with. So let's hover over to the threaded section in the C-clamp body, and let's go ahead and make sure we're hovering over this inner circular area, hold the control key to make our selection easier, and then let's pick up that middle point there. Left click, and then now the part snaps over to it. Now, let me talk briefly about the animate option that's available to us. So you'll currently see that we have this little play button here. And when we hit that play button, it does a quick little animation of the motion characteristics that are available for this joint relationship. Now, you can also check this automatic playing option. And so what happens with this is once I make my selection, okay, left click, it'll automatically play that animation for me. Now, since I'm familiar with the various joint operations, I typically leave that unchecked because I don't need to see that animation. But as you're starting out with this particular tool, I recommend that you leave that on so that you can make sure that you have the correct animation for what you're trying to do. Let's go ahead and work our way back up to the connect section and take a look at this flip component button. So when we click on that, it just flips the component upside down. Okay, it inverts it by 180 degrees. And then this little box here allows us to pick our parts first. So I'll cancel this, go back into joint. And when we have this checked off, instead of showing me the nodes right away when this is unchecked, so you see how it's showing me the nodes right away, when we have that checked, it forces us to select the part that we want first, and then we can select the nodes after clicking. Okay, so this is useful for when you have a ton of parts in your assembly and you need a little bit more precise control over picking the correct part first and then picking up the nodes that are relevant to that part. Moving down to the align section, this is where we can actually modify the alignment of our two parts in reference to one another within the joint command. So you'll see that our first alignment selection filter is already selected, and I know that because I have the blue fill inside of the box. And what we want to do is we want to use this hole, or specifically the axis inside of this hole, as our pointing cue for our screw alignment. Okay, so now that we already have that selected, we can click on the second alignment option here, and you'll see that this wall is pre-selected. Okay, but what we want to go ahead and do is show you the different options that you can use for alignment. So as I rotate this mouse cursor around, the screw rotates. Okay, but let's say I want to snap this hole in alignment with an edge. So I can hover over an edge and you'll see it snaps to that edge. So I can pick up that edge, or if I want to snap it normal to a face, you'll see that the arrow is sticking out normal from that C-clamp body if I want it in alignment with that, which in this case I do. So let's go ahead and do that. So we'll hover over that and left click, and now we snapped our alignment to that. And then lastly, we have our invert alignment button. So when I click that, it just flips the part around 180 degrees. So pay attention to this little origin arrow here. When I click that, you'll see the one for the screw flips 180 degrees in reference to the other one, okay? So that is what your invert alignment button does. Now that we have our two parts aligned and positioned the way we want them to be, let's go to the name section and give this a custom name. So I'm just gonna call this screw joint, just so I know exactly what this is for. So now that we have our custom name in there, we can go ahead and move over to our limits tab to see exactly what we have to work with here. So under our limits tab, this is where we can control our angular and linear limits. So our angular limits will control by how much this part can rotate. Since this is a screw, I'm not going to implement any sort of angular limits, but I will show you what this does. So to actually have an angular limit, either at the start or the end, you can check or uncheck either one of these boxes. So in this case, currently it's at 0 degrees. So these central boxes tell you exactly where its position is within this joint operation in 3D space. Let's say, for example, we only want the screw to be able to rotate by 90 degrees from its start point. Well, all you would have to do is make sure that this end box is checked, and then you can type in 90 degrees in this box. You can also press this little right arrow in any one of these boxes and measure a dimension or a feature within your assembly and use that value as your entry for this parameter. Okay, so we'll go ahead and leave 90 in the box, and then we'll hit OK. Now, when we go to rotate this part in the model, you'll see it only wants to rotate by 90 degrees. So pay attention to this little hole down here. It only rotates by 90 degrees. Moving down to the linear section, let's say that we want this to be our start point. So we want to go from the end of the threads here all the way up to the end of the threads here for our linear travel. So we can click the start box, use the current setting as our start option, and we can check the end box. And I went ahead and found the displacement that we want here, and I'm going to paste that in here. Okay, now what you can also do is you can exit out of this editing menu and then drag your part up and down, and that changes the current option. And then once you get those values, you can come back and copy and paste them into your start and end box if you want to do it that way. So let's go ahead and rotate this around, and then let's go ahead and click OK. Now when we click OK, you'll notice we can only drag this down to that endpoint that we set. Okay, so we have that start and end point. If we didn't have these, the screw would just go infinitely in either direction. Let's move on to our next joint option, which is our rigid option. So for this particular example, we're going to be bringing in the little pin for the handle of this C-clamp. So let's go ahead and drop it anywhere in 3D space. Click OK in our marking menu. And then we go back to joint and let's select rigid. So normally, if you're going to do constraints and we wanted this pin centered to this hole, you would have to create a cylindrical constraint or like an insert constraint, and then you would have to set a gap option. But with the joint tool, since this is going to be an interference fit in this particular design and we don't want this pin sliding around in this hole and we want it centered up as well, we can use this to snap to the center point. Okay, then we can hover over the hole here, hold control, and then hover over here to this center point, left click, and you'll notice this goes into that location. You'll see it sort of vibrates around a little bit. That's how it tells me that this is a rigid constraint. So that's what that animation is telling me. And I went ahead and centered everything up and locked it into place all in one step. And so now that that is complete, I can go ahead and click OK. You can also set a gap value. So let's say I wanted to set a gap between the two center origins of those two parts by, let's say, an eighth of an inch. So I can type in 0.125 and it'll set that gap value to an eighth of an inch. Okay, so you get the idea for gap. And then of course you have your measure option here, so you can pick up and measure various entities within your model and use that as an input parameter for this gap option, or you can pick up some previous entries that you may have entered in the past. Okay. Let's go ahead and name this. So interference fit for the pen. So we'll click OK there. And then of course you have your limits option as well, but in this case, we don't want to use that and we can't use it because it's a rigid joint. Click OK. And there we go. Now we have our handle in place. Moving on to our ball joint, I went ahead and brought in a pad that fits on the end of this little ball at the end of the screw. And then on the inside of this is a spherical cavity that fits over that ball. So let's go to joint, drop down, ball. Okay, let's hover over this cavity here and you'll see it's our spherical cavity. Let's hold control so that we can easily pick up that center point. I want to pick the center of the sphere. Okay, and then let's pick up the center of this sphere. So left click. Now it's going to play the little animation of the movements that are available as part of this joint. Okay, and then now when we execute this command, and actually let's go ahead and name this real quick. So let's name this ball joint. Okay, hit okay. And then now we can click and drag that around. The next joint type that I want to talk about is the planar joint. Okay, so you'll see that I already have an aluminum block clamped to the table. Okay, so that's not moving anywhere, but I brought in a second aluminum block that we're going to set on top of the table, and we want it to be able to slide around two dimensionally. So it's able to slide around on the table, and then we can actually rotate it as well around its normal axis that sticks up from the table surface through its center of gravity. So what we want to do first is we want to pick up the central point on the bottom. We want to pick the center point on the table, for example, and let's let it do its animation. So you see it's rotating and it's able to translate about the tabletop. So it's able to slide around. Okay, we can also set a gap value. So we could set a gap of, let's say, half an inch off the tabletop. So let me just rotate that around. But in this case, since we want it to slide on the tabletop, we want this to be zero. And then let's just rename this to planar, okay, and hit OK. Now, when I click and drag this, I can slide it about, or let me rotate this around. I can rotate this about, so I can rotate this on the table. And, you know, just move this freely as described in that motion preview. The next joint type we're going to be talking about is the rotational joint. So in this particular example, I have half of a liftoff hinge here. So we have the bottom portion of the hinge, we have a pin that sticks up, and then we have another half that sets on top and it rotates it about. So I have this set as grounded, so this is currently fixed in space, and we're going to bring in the other side of this hinge. So let's look at our rotation models here, and we want the moving side. Okay, so I'll just drop that somewhere in 3D space and hit OK in our marking menu. Now I want to go ahead and go up to joint, and let's set this to rotational. So for our first entity, we want to select the inner portion of this. Now in this case, in this particular joint, this bottom face sets on this face here. Okay, so this hinge will come out over top of this pin. So what we want to do is we want to pick up this bottom point here, left click, and then hover over this and pick up this bottom point, okay? Left click, and that's going to create that rotation joint there for me. So it's showing me my degree of freedom, which is that one rotation axis. And we can go into limits and set our angular constraints if we want to, our angular limits. And then we have our usual controls on this side that you should now be familiar with. So now we can go ahead and just rename this real quick. We'll name it hinge. Click OK, and then now we have our rotational entity. The final joint type I'd like to talk about in this video is the slider joint type. So for this example, I brought in some aluminum T-slot frame from a distributor I like to use, and a sleeve bearing. So this bearing essentially sits on this rail, and it allows for linear travel along this rail. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to position this central to this rail to where all of these little grooves line up with the slots here and allows for that linear travel. Let's go ahead and pick up our first origin, which is going to lie on this bottom face here. We'll pick up that center node. What I'm planning on doing here is setting a gap between this bottom face and this top face of the rail. Okay, so let's go ahead and pick the central node of the top face. It'll give me a motion preview. We get a single direction of travel, and that's a linear motion along the length of the rail here in this particular case. And let's go ahead and set our gap. I went ahead and found this ahead of time, so I'm gonna paste that in there. We have our gap set properly now. So the sleeve bearing is no longer inside of the T-slot frame. It's on top of it like it should be. We'll change the name to slider. And you have the ability to set a linear limit if you want to do that as well. So let's go ahead and hit OK. Rotate that around. We can click and drag this, and you can see it only slides in that one direction as intended. That's all for this segment of the Autodesk Inventor assembly creation module, where I gave you an overview of the joint command. I really hope that you found this tutorial to be helpful and that you put what you've learned into practice so you can continue developing your skills as you work your way through these lessons. Also, before you watch the next video in the series, make sure you subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications to stay up to date on future content that will help you create the future you want for yourself. And of course, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out via my website contact page and let me know if there's anything else you'd like to learn about or see on this channel. I really appreciate you choosing to stop by and learn with me, and I'll see you again soon.